iOS 18 was just released, but I don't want to focus on the big major features that everyone's already been talking about, like locked and hidden apps, the new control center, or the new iMessage reactions. Instead, I want to talk about features that are more hidden, meaning they're not even mentioned in Apple's supposed list of all new features they publish as a PDF. So let's get into it, first with the features that Apple didn't mention anywhere. Starting off, iOS will now tell you in the battery settings if you're using a slow charger. It will appear right above the battery graph, and for this example, I used one of those little 5-volt Apple chargers, and it also shows in the charging history as orange bars anytime a slow charger was used. This might not appear instantly right after you plug it in. One time I noticed it took maybe 30 seconds, while another time it did pretty much show up right away. It might vary. Next, while you're recording a video, there is now a pause option, so you can pause while recording and then continue it, and it will be the same video file. To continue recording, you press the left button again. You can also stop it at any point in the middle button, and you can also always take a picture by hitting the right button. Speaking of videos, when you're looking at a video in the Photos app, there's a new video scrubber. It now shows a dedicated bar on the video itself instead of kind of being in line with the carousel like it was before. And also another change is videos loop now when they get to the end instead of just stopping like before. Moving on, here's a cool new feature for sharing your Wi-Fi password with friends. It's in the new Passwords app. If you go into the Wi-Fi section and then go to whatever network you're on and then hit show network QR code, it'll show a QR code and your friends can just use the Photos app to connect your Wi-Fi. Next up, this one is really cool. For certain iPhone models, with the flashlight, you can now adjust the beam width, not just the intensity. It seems that this feature is only available for iPhones with the so-called adaptive true tone flash, which are basically pro models since the 14 Pro, because those actually have an array of 9 LEDs and a different lens shape. It seems like there's a middle long distance lens and an outer one. And it really does make the center of the beam brighter than it would be if you just had it on full blast. All right, next up, this is one probably most people would realize quickly anyway, but there's a new dedicated apps section in the settings menu instead of it all just being on one page. It apparently includes both Apple apps and third-party apps all just lumped together. So, for example, even the phone app is just in here. I kind of wish those ones were separate, but it is what it is. Next, a couple little changes to lock screen customization. Now, with the clock, there's a new gradient option. It's more of like a rainbow, and you can make it look like that. And also for the astronomy planet photos, there's this new magic sparkle option, which seems to just be a pre-chosen color that fits that particular image for each one. Now, in the new control center, one little thing I want to point out is there is now finally an on-screen power button at the top right. You do have to tap and briefly hold it, and you'll get some haptic feedback, and then it'll bring up the power off thing like you're used to. And also, it's worth noting that doing this will lock the phone in a way that you have to actually type in the passcode, so Face ID or Touch ID won't work, just like if you had held the power buttons down. All right, next up in the phone app, it now supports T9 dialing, meaning when going to dial, you can actually type in the numbers that correspond to the text of the person's name. For example, I created this contact with the name example contact, and the number is just a bunch of fives. But if I go to the dialer and enter the numbers corresponding to E, X, and A, meaning 392, the example contact shows up at the top now. And then you can tap to select it and fill it in. And if there's multiple matches, you can hit the more option to list them all. Of course, you can still type in a number if you want. Moving on, there's a new way to add widgets to your home screen. If you long press on an app, you'll now have an option to convert it to a widget by then pressing on one of these icons if there is a widget available, and also choose the size of the widget. You can also convert it back if it's already a widget, though I did notice if the app has multiple possible widgets, like this clock app, then you can only do this with the default one. Otherwise, for one of the other widgets, you would have to manually go to the Add Widgets menu and then choose one of the other ones. All right, here's a little cool one that might fly under the radar. In the Shortcuts app, when you go to create a shortcut with an if statement, you can now have multiple if conditions for the same thing. For example, if I add some random condition like a date, I now have an option to hit the plus button and then add more, and then you can choose if any or if all are true. Whereas before, you can see that there was no option for this at all. And you can also even add more than two if you wanted. And next up, this is another technical little feature having to do with the private Wi-Fi address feature. You can now actually choose between using a fixed or rotating private address. For most people, you don't really have to care about this though. All right, so now let's get onto some more lesser known features that I found while digging through the changelog and are not mentioned on the main big features page. Real quick though, a shameless plug for my truly hilarious Instagram account. For God's sake, don't go on there if you have a heart condition. You'll die of laughter or die from cringing so hard at my attempts at humor. So if you want to check that out, it's just at TheoJoe over on Instagram. All right, so onto the lesser known features, starting off with a couple for the camera. There is now a new option for a 5-second timer. Before it was just 3 and 10 seconds. And also, to control the flash, you can now press and hold on that top left flash button to pop out all 3 settings, just as if you had swiped up for the full controls. Before, all you could do was tap it and toggle between auto and off, though you can still do that. Next, in the phone app, you can now search through recent call history. You can search by the person's name or caller ID, or type in their number, and you can even search by the date. So if you type in August, it will filter for calls in August. Next, here's a cool little new feature in the wallet app. You can now tap to provision cards, meaning to add certain cards, you can now just tap it on your phone instead of having to type in the number and everything. I was able to do this with a MasterCard that I had, and I assume it just supports any card or most cards that have the tap to pay feature. All right, next up, we got a bunch of really cool new convenient features in the Photos app that I don't think a lot of people have noticed. So first of all, and this is gonna be more interesting than it sounds, I promise, the folders feature in Photos is no longer useless. If you even knew about the folders feature before, the idea is that folders let you organize whole albums together, whereas like albums are to photos, folders are to albums. But before, it was kind of useless because you could not add existing albums to folders, but now you can. So for example, you know all those annoying albums that are automatically created by random apps? Now I can just put them all in their own folder that I call auto-created to reduce all that clutter. And yes, the photos from the app still go into the one within the folder. You can even put one folder within another folder, nest them, and of course, take albums out of folders. Next, this is a big one. There's new filtering options with this filter button at the bottom left. And one thing you could do with this is something I've been waiting for forever, and that is sort by recently added, not by the captured date in the metadata. For example, you probably experienced this. If you ever went to download a photo, like this example, which is tagged with the date of 1996, something really old, and then when you go to save it and look for it in the Photos app, it's nowhere to be seen because it ended up getting shoved deep in the middle somewhere in the photo library with whatever date. But now you can have everything just show up by the date you added it, which makes a lot more sense. You can also use this filter button to hide screenshots from the grid if you do view options and then uncheck screenshots. And that will also hide screen recordings. And interestingly, it'll even hide photos of screens. Like I tested this picture of the screen with just Notepad open and it did actually hide that along with other screenshots. Keep in mind, it takes a bit of time in the background to analyze the photos to categorize them, so it might not disappear immediately after you take a picture of the screen, for example, but it should work eventually. Also, if you do choose to hide the screenshots, you can then create like a pinned collection, that's a new feature, just with the screenshots, and then they'll all still be accessible. And one more thing with this filter button, you can also use the filter option to only show pictures of a certain category. Another change in the Photos app, there's more of these little utilities section, and these are almost like special albums. Before, there was just sections for imports, duplicates, hidden, and recently deleted, but now there's a bunch more, like recently viewed, recently edited, receipts, QR codes, documents, so that could come in handy. And then here's a new feature while editing a photo. If you make certain adjustments and then go to copy edits, you'll see this new adaptive option, which is enabled by default. Basically, it seems that if you keep this enabled while you copy the edits and then go to paste them, it will try to make it, I guess, look similar to the previous one, even if the conditions weren't exactly the same. It seems this new adaptive option will only show up if you make adjustments beyond just the automatic tool. If you only use the automatic filter, it'll only show the adjust option, probably because that effect is inherently adaptive. All right, next up are some sleeper changes in iMessage that I'm really excited about. First of all, you probably already know that you can now react to messages with any emoji or sticker, but what you might not realize is you can now insert inline stickers just like you would an emoji. So basically, you can kind of create your own emojis and it'll be just in the message without being a separate big giant image. So now you can use all your unhinged, ridiculous stickers just like you would any other emoji. Next, here's a change that is more behind the scenes, but really good. And that is that iMessage will now send the full quality and resolution of photos that are much larger, up to 100 megabytes, I assumed that it always did this for full quality, but apparently there was some kind of size limit, and me and my friends would notice that occasionally we would send pictures in the group chat and it would just show up super small. Hopefully that is a thing of the past. And then here's a major one for people with friends or family with Android, and that is full RCS support. RCS stands for Rich Communication Services, and it will now allow you to interact with Android phones and both ways, be able to do things like supporting delivered messages, typing status, stuff like that. Now, this is going to depend on if your carrier supports it. I know the big ones will, and you can check if you go into the settings and then general and then about, and then if you tap on your carrier, see where it says IMS status, it should say RCS. It might take some time for carriers to roll out this update, and also you have to make sure that the person on the Android phone supports it with whatever app they're using. I know that the Google Messages app works with that, but other third-party texting apps might not. All right, moving on, a couple new accessibility features that are actually useful to anyone. One is vocal shortcuts, and you get to this by going to accessibility settings and then vocal shortcuts. And here you can type in a phrase that will be the trigger word basically, and then say it 3 times to train it. And you can trigger either custom shortcuts even, so basically anything, or some predefined actions. Here, I use an example of a shortcut that I have already, and then if I say that phrase at any time, you don't have to activate Siri, it will then trigger that shortcut. Another new feature, which is actually enabled by default, is vehicle motion cues. And you can find this in the accessibility settings under motion and then show motion vehicle cues. And it's set to automatic by default, but you can toggle it manually. And basically the idea is this is for reducing motion sickness by showing dots on the screen that kind of use the gyroscope to move relative to like the car, as opposed to if you're staring at the phone, sometimes when the phone is not moving, but your brain feels the outside moving, it can mess with you. For some people, it's worse, and apparently this really helps. There's also an action you can put in the control center to toggle this on and off. All right, now we can get on to some changes to the calculator. Yes, this has been revamped. First of all, you'll notice there's a new history button at the top left to see previous calculations, and you could also use the backspace button, which is new, instead of having to swipe like you did before that almost no one knew about, and you can also hold that to clear everything. There's also this new button at the bottom left you can press, and it will show options to go into basic mode, scientific mode, and math notes, which hold off on that for a second. And there's also this new convert mode. The scientific mode just looks like this. Previously, you had to turn your phone sideways to access all this, and convert mode is gonna come in handy. You basically tap to change what you want to convert to and from, and there's tons of possible units. Everything from just currency to data, energy, stuff like that. And then there's the very interesting math notes mode. And here you can create a note and it looks like just regular notes. However, you can do cool stuff like if I type out something x = 5, x is now a variable. So if below it, I then do 2x, you can see it auto completes the suggestion to 10. And if I hit return to accept it, it types that out. Or we can also do something like y = 3x, and it will show an option to insert the graph and actually put a graph of the equation. So obviously you can do a lot more, that's just simple examples, but this could come in handy. So let me know down in the comments if you're excited about these as much as I am, and if I missed any, definitely let me know down there, and be sure to check down there because someone probably pointed out one that I did miss. Now, next up, I would recommend you watch my previous year's video about iOS 17 hidden features because those are still there and you still might not know about them. So I'll put that link right there you can click on. And again, consider checking out my stupid Instagram @TheoJoe over on there. And anyway, thanks for watching and I'll see you in the next video.